Hey guys, Etalyx here with a game called Scrap Mechanic, due out to release in just a few days on Steam Early Access. Comes out on the 20th of January, but don't be alarmed by the Early Access and the title. There's already so much to build in this Tinkerer's Sandbox. So if you like games like Space Engineers or Besiege in more recent memory, perhaps even Kerbal Space Program, you'll probably find something here in Scrap Mechanic to scratch that builder's itch that you have. Right now, there's only a creative mode, but the fact that I can select creative mode indicates to me there will be other game modes over time. In addition, this whole environment that you're seeing here can be played with friends online. Though I have not tried that out myself, I suspect there may be a few hiccups here and there because this game's very heavily physics-based. Lots of focus on automation of different properties we're going to be taking a closer look at as we arrive at my quaint little house that, believe it or not, took me like 3+ hours to build. That's right, I could have had this video up sooner, but I wanted to spend an adequate amount of time learning the basics so I have at least a beginner's understanding of how to explain the more intricate systems in Scrap Mechanics, starting with the door. That's right, the door. This is what took me so long. I'm gonna zoom into first person here. Don't mind my giant hammer. It's not gonna hurt anything. The door. Let's focus. Push the button. And watch as this almost piston Minecraft redstone style door opens, revealing a very cozy home within. Caution, there are automated facilities here, mostly a door. We got a radio that we can turn on. We've got little birdie, my personal favorite. Make sure you keep your toilet paper nice and handy because we got no toilet over here, just a sink. These are all for decorative purposes. The real meat and potatoes is what goes on under the hood. That's enough out of you, radio. See all these purple lines? Each one connects from this tool here, called the controller, to a bearing. So all of these little circles are bearings. What's a bearing, Etalyx? We'll take a closer look at that right now. Let's go outside, where it's a little bit more roomy, less claustrophobic. First, we need to find the lift on the hotbar here. Go ahead and place it down. Each player gets one such lift. It can rise up and down. You probably already can tell exactly what it's useful for. It gives you a foundation so that when you begin building, let's say you build way out here and you want to get up underneath these blocks, but you can't. Lift them up. There is no fly mode here, you Minecrafters. You gotta do everything the old-fashioned way, or perhaps if something's too high and you need to build yourself a little bit higher, perhaps you'll open up the backpack and find a such tool that will allow you to get to that height. Yep, you know it, building blocks in steps and stairs to get higher if needed. Everything's gotta be a little bit more manual around here. Anyway, I digress. Let's work on making a simple door. That is a very complex door, and we'll take another look at it. I'll replay it for you here in just a moment. But left-clicking, as you might guess, places objects, and holding down right-click will delete them. There is so much to discuss for seemingly simple mechanics here that I might get easily distracted. Let's focus. I'm going to select the bearing now, which is lesson number one in Scrap Mechanic, and build it. Now you'll notice every time I build something, you see a hammer quickly appear on the right side of the screen. That is important, because anything you build is going to see that hammer, but there's a distinction between building on a block and building on a bearing. The drill appears when you connect a block to a bearing. That's really important. Remember that detail. So now, every block that we attach to this block is also going to be indirectly attached to that bearing. So what I'm doing now is just building a small wooden door. We're a little bit taller than the door, but that's okay for the purposes of this demonstration. And I'm also going to extend our floor just a little bit in this general direction. You don't have to do just straight lines. You can do wider arcs as well, or bigger rectangles or squares or what have you. So now that we've got a wall, I want to place two more tools that are going to help us on this wall. One is going to be a switch. There are a few different types of toggles. A switch obviously toggles on and off. There's also a button, which will activate for as long as you're pushing the button down. And then there's a sensor, which detects movement, so it's quite advanced. We're going to stick with the switch for now, and I recommend the same thing for you. So that switch, that bearing, are going to talk to each other. They're going to make some machine love right now. As soon as we select a very important tool called the connection tool. This is how you get all of their machines to work in tandem and harmony. Notice how even though these bearings are obscured by blocks, I can still see where they are. So you get x-ray vision while you're using the connection tool. And unfortunately, we cannot just connect up the switch to the bearing like that. We need to go one step further and utilize the controller. The controller is how we're going to kind of program each of these blocks. Now, don't get lost just yet. It's not as hard as it seems. It depends on how difficult you want to make it. So we'll put the controller down, and now we'll go back to the connection tool, hook up the switch to the controller, and then the controller to the bearing. Look, there's a little arrow indicating rotation, a blue and a red. I'm going to put away this tool so you can see the controller properly, and hit E, and we have a series of what are kind of like keyframes in animation. So we want that door to rotate, right? Remember how I said there were different color arrows? Which way do we want it to rotate? If we want it to go out, we want to head towards the red. So I am going to drag 90 degrees to the red. That makes for a normal door, right? But if we want to use this switch, first we have to get it off. Remember, this is on the lift. So we don't want to have this on the lift. Even though this is still really useful for us to build things, all we have to do is pick it back up, and it'll drop our creation. The handy thing about the lift is you can continue building here. See how the whole thing is highlighted white? I can just left-click this, pick it up, and move my creation anywhere. So if you happen to accidentally build something, say a car, yes, you can make vehicles. There's engines and wheels. And flip it over. That's how you're going to flip it right side up. But anyway, we want to get this off of the lift for now, because while it's on the lift, it disables using the switch. What magic? What sorcery is that, Etalyx? It's very simple, remember? The switch is connected to the controller, and the controller tells the bearing to spin 90 degrees towards the red. It is that concept that I have taken and expounded upon to make a series of bearings here, around 10 or so, that when activated, produces this. Now you want to see how complicated my controller for this door looks compared to that simple door. Let's go inside and find out. What? You have two controllers? Yes, I actually had to have two. You can see both of them are hooked up to one switch. Unfortunately, I have not been able to figure out how to hook up two switches to two controllers. So I don't think this is possible. Only one switch per set, it appears. Either way, let's open up the controllers now and whoa! This is suddenly looking like raiding the Matrix here. Yeah, it took a lot of trial and error. This is what took me like 3 hours to do. So they have different phases. So, for example, when we hit the switch, and this is going to be awkward because we should be on the outside, it's going to activate phase 1, then phase 2, then phase 3, then phase 4, then phase 5. So for each tick of the animation, how long into the cycle this spins 90 degrees backwards, it needs 4 ticks. So during that time, other elements in my door are spinning and maneuvering around to try to make room for that. And that's how it works in a nutshell. Now, if you want to learn more detail on how to make a big advanced contraption like that, we'll probably cover that perhaps in another video if you guys are interested in seeing some more on Scrap Mechanic, of course. But I don't want to just leave it there at how to make a door. Let's go make a car. I mentioned cars, how can I not, right? Got this little framework here for us to begin with. Something really simple. I don't want to build that complex machine because it's going to take me hours. Let's make just a basic car, but one that has a little bit of rotation and bearing and movement. In fact, I've already got 4 bearings on here, and these will prove to be important. In fact, we need more bearings. A lot more bearings, because how are the wheels going to spin unless they have a bearing with which to spin? So, place the bearing down, then place the wheel on top of it. We get the drill to indicate, indeed, we have connected it properly. Let's go ahead and place one all the way around before getting the rest of these wheels. And, Etalyx, why are you building the wheels so close together? Well, that's the part that's going to move. They're going to flip over and around and lift the car up off the ground. That's the idea anyway. Now we need to select the driver's seat. This is how we're going to be steering. We can hop on board and we can even make passenger seats. So if you're playing with your friends, you want to show them your cool new ride, give them a passenger seat. I'm sure they'd love it. Let's put the steering wheel here in the back, and we can't go anywhere without an engine. Engines are not necessary for your day-to-day operations of bearings. They are necessary in order to propel your car forward, though. There is an electric engine or a gas engine. The gas engine is very powerful. And if you want to go a step further, thrusters. If you feel like making some hovercrafts, that's perfectly viable as well. Some suspension to make sure that you can bounce along. We're not going to get that advanced, though. Placing the engine right here in front. And you can see already we've got a lot more connections to make now. But to make those connections, remember, we still need a controller, and we still need a Switch to get this started. So I'm going to place a Switch down here in the front, and the controller rotated around, and hide it in one of these little nooks and crannies. See, I told you this was going to be really compact. But we're not done yet. Now I need to hook some stuff up. Even though this is a simple car, I know it's very easy to get lost in the explanation, so I've only got four things connected up to the controller. One, two, three, four bearings. They all mirror each other, so they're essentially the same, just in opposite sides of the vehicle. Now we want to connect up the Switch, which we've got here, and we can push E to use, indicated by the pink, up to the controller. So when we push the Switch now, it should activate the controller and all of those bearings. But wait, you remember something? Etalyx, I failed math class. How do I do this? It's really easy. I want these wheels to flip 180 degrees around. Let's see what happens when I just do one wheel 180 degrees. All right? We just picked one. Keep it nice and easy. Oh, now it's starting to make sense. Okay, the wheel kind of propped itself up. We can flip it back around the same way. In fact, hitting the button and turning it off will just reverse whatever direction it initially went. It doesn't have to reverse. That's what this button down here is for. You can have a looping if you want to. So now that we've turned it on, it's just gonna keep spinning. So if you ever wanted to make something that walks by itself, a walker instead of a wheeled vehicle, that's how you might be able to do that, if you're conniving enough. Unfortunately, that's not the direction I want anything to rotate, so let's go 180 degrees towards the red instead. The reason why, that's better, hang on, hold on. The machine is coming alive! Everything is under control. We just need to get the other three wheels spinning. Remember how I changed it to red specifically? We can look at the other indicators to see which way we want to spin these. I want to go two blue and four red. Two blue, so two, we're going to go blue. And then four, we're going to go red. And if that doesn't make any sense, well, I don't know how better to explain it. I'm just looking at the arrows and I want it to spin up and over, so I'm following that red arrow. And then finally, we have number three, which I want to go 180 to the blue. And with that, upon activation, there we go. Car's sprouting to life. Let's not get too carried away in celebration. There's still a few things left to connect. I want to be able to steer the car, right? Yeah. Well, how am I going to do that? That's right. I don't have any steering bearings, because let's look what happens right now. Let's just see what happens, all right? We're going to hook up the engine to the wheels. This is going to enable the wheels to spin. And we're also going to hook up the engine to the Switch. So now when we hit E to flip the Switch, it should turn on the engine. But wait, we have to activate the engine first. It's on the off setting at the moment. There's some juice. Now it's coming to life. Well, it was. There we go. It's not going anywhere, Etalyx. Let's hop in. I can't steer left or right. I can't even move forward. That's right. We're not done. There's yet more to do, but that's how you power the wheels. You can see they're trying to spin, but what's the problem? Oh, some of them are spinning backwards. Let's hit that right mouse button to try to reverse the direction. We're tearing up the dirt over here. I think there's only one left. Now it should go forward. Everything is uniform, we can hop in and enjoy the ride. That's it. Steering left, right, doesn't work. We're almost there, guys! There's only one more step left, and that is to make sure that this does not get away from us. To get proper steering, we need one more set of bearings. Those bearings are going to go underneath a little elevated metal block that I'm going to build up. So the two in the back don't need it, because I don't need the two rear wheels to steer left and right, just the front two. So with that bearing, before we get the wheels down, let's attach it to the driver's seat with the connector and try it out for ourselves. Let's just hop in. There we go, see? That's exactly what those bearings were meant to do, turn left and right. So how do we make that translate into a drivable car? We just do the same thing we had before. We need bearings for all four wheels, and then we need to hook those wheels up to the power. We're almost there, guys. I can taste it. And the connector tool is also going to allow us to do one more fancy trick. So I'm just connecting the engine to all the wheels to make sure that they are powered. And I want to make sure, of course, that they're going the same direction, forwards preferably as well. Let's hook up the driver's seat to the Switch. Why, you may ask? Let's hop in and find out. Did you guys know I was Gumby? Connecting the driver's seat to the Switch shows a Switch in the hotbar while I'm sitting in the car. So if you have a bunch of Switches for a multi-stage vehicle, then you can activate all those Switches with the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So let's do it. Oh, my steering is backwards. And I've only got one power in my engine, so I don't think I'm going to be able to make it back up this hill. All right, let's put it back together. I can park it without having to manually flip the Switch. I can just hit that number 1 key. That is so good. Okay, let's rotate both of my steering columns. And then we want to probably soup up our engine a little bit more. Let's go up to 3 and jump back in and see how this works for us. The engine turns on immediately, and now it is strong enough to help us climb this hill. Now, you have to be careful with the engine, because if you put it all the way to its max settings for such a tiny vehicle that weighs as little as this one, see how far I'm getting just thrown around? This is only on the number 3 setting. Oh, jeez. We're out of control. They told me I could be anything, so I became a pancake. Yeah, we got a problem here. Folding it up did not help. I am now getting claustrophobic just watching this happen. This is my life now. I guess this is my prison. No? Oh, we could just pop back out, and that is exactly what the lift is for. Pick it up, set it down, destroy the lift, you're good to go. Ready to cruise the streets in your brand new car. All right, one final look at the fancy door as I let you know that I'd be happy to make even more videos on Scrap Mechanic. There is so much to try out here. Obviously, it's gonna take some time to build these fancy mechanics. Look at all of those individual bearings and how many of them folds into this beautiful entrance to my home. Unfortunately, I can only close it and lock myself in once from the inside. Interior. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. Let me know what you think down below. Again, Scrap Mechanic comes out on the 20th on Steam. Don't know the price just yet, but it's got a lot here in early access that should keep you busy if you enjoy creative building, especially with friends. My name is Etalyx, and I'll see you next time, mechanics.